John Andrews, OBE. He's an honorary officer of the Order of the British Empire for everything he has done in the name of Shakespeare. He is an editor, educator, a cultural leader with a wide experience as a writer, a lecturer, a consultant, an event producer, a series producer. He worked on a huge project called the Shakespeare Plays, which we will talk a little bit about in our interview. He has produced many books on Shakespeare, which we will also get to. He founded the Shakespeare Guild, which is a global nonprofit organization to foster a deeper appreciation of the world's most influential writer, William Shakespeare. And not too many years after the founding of that, he established the Sir John Gielgud Award for Excellence in the Dramatic Arts, which is, I think, one of the most appreciated and highly respected awards in the acting profession. So without much more, I bring on John Andrews. Hello, John, how are you?
I'm fine, Shana. Thank you for that lovely, generous introduction. I'm delighted to know that we're benefiting the Dutch Treat Club. That's an organization I admire. And I also wanted to make sure that everybody knows that you have a husband who is not only a lawyer, but a terrific actor, Jeffrey Hardy.
Correct, yes.
And a son who is a budding thespian named Austin.
Yes.
And I'm hoping to see both of them on a stage with you sometime in the near future.
We'll
I think
see.
This could be a great family act.
So, since you are now being interviewed and you're not the interviewer, we've switched the table, I want to know how you knew Shakespeare was your calling. I mean, it seems to me in the reading I have done that you knew pretty well in even your young adulthood, maybe even your childhood, that Shakespeare was meaningful to you. So I guess my question would be, when did you know, and what was the aha moment, I guess?
Well, that's a very good question. I actually didn't know a lot of Shakespeare. I had, I remember reading Julius Caesar, I think during my sophomore year in high school, and being not as impressed as I probably should have been. And then later taking a course, I believe as a senior in high school, and reading other plays. But again, you know, not really catching on to what made Shakespeare special. And I think it was really a course in my sophomore year at Princeton as an undergraduate. And I had a brilliant professor named Sherman Hawkins, who really knew how to get students involved in getting really engaged in the language and the problems that the playwright addresses and so forth. I think that's really a pivotal moment for me. I, at that point, had been planning to major in architecture.
Oh.
And so I switched to English and then went on to earn a degree in teaching at the Harvard Graduate School of Education, followed by a doctorate at Vanderbilt. And it was really at Vanderbilt that I finally decided that I would focus my primary research on Shakespeare. So, but I'm glad I did. It turns out he's very good company.
Yeah, well, and you seem to jump kind of right into the world of education and furthering the works of Shakespeare.
I think Shakespeare, among other things, is maybe our foremost educator. I can't think of anyone who can teach us more about what Jay Islin of WNET called the mileposts of life.
Right. Well,
yeah.
Who was it? And maybe it's not, this isn't coined to just one person, but isn't the saying, every story and movie that we see nowadays has some nod to Shakespeare, that the theme has been written already, I guess.
Maybe not everyone, but certainly, certainly a lot of them. No question about it. Shakespeare is, among other things, a fountain that keeps flowing. And of course, you've experienced it not only in drama, but in music and in other fields. So, you know, it's there's no limit to Shakespeare's influence.
Right. I mean, so I, like you, had the high school classes with Shakespeare. I think my sophomore year was Romeo and Juliet. I think that's the first one we started off with.
Yes.
Yeah. And then senior year was Hamlet.
Uh-huh.
And I did enjoy, you know, dissecting the sentences word for word, to make it, you know, more translatable for a kid who's a senior in high school to really understand the story and what's going on. But I did understand that part of the learning. But I have to say, it wasn't until in choir my senior year, we sang Sonnet 29. And, you know, of course, we read the sonnets as well, but Sonnet 29 was put to music, a beautiful version. And of course, I didn't write it down. I can't remember it. It's on YouTube. Madrigal type music for a four voice choir, Sonnet 29. And my choir director was so passionate about making sure we understood exactly what the sonnet was about. You know, 16, 17, and 18 year olds.
That's right.
And it wasn't until I heard it to music that then I was able to really, you know, bring it in and love the words. And I think that's what made me appreciate the words of Shakespeare. And then of course I started reading the plays and whatnot. But I think educating the younger generation is very important. And I'd like to know, you know, it's a very different younger generation now today.
Yes.
Than it was when I went to school, than it was when you went to school. What are some of the things that teachers and educators should really be focusing on in today's education with Shakespeare?
I think, first of all, it's important for everyone to realize that Shakespeare is fun. If Shakespeare is work, if it becomes drudgery, I think that can be very self-defeating. And so one of the things that I've most enjoyed, it was during my 7 years as head of the Washington branch of the English-speaking Union in DC, when we were taking part in the English-speaking Union's National Shakespeare Competition. And that meant working with schools who would prepare students to do a monologue and a sonnet and present those as part of a little festival. And I served as a judge several times before I ended up overseeing the program. And one of the things that I found was that it was useful to develop some guidelines for students on not only on acting, but just on how to approach the language. Being aware of the verse forms, for example, and paying attention to how they work, and again making that fun. And one of the things that I most enjoyed was talking about the ways in which Shakespeare would establish a norm and then deviate from it. So that, for example, when Polonius is talking to Gertrude and Claudius about the strange behavior of Hamlet, he says, therefore, since brevity is the soul of wit, and tediousness the limbs and outward flourishes, I will be brief. In that line, the only way you can make brevity work, therefore, since brevity is the soul of wit, is to abbreviate brevity into two syllables rather than three. And then in the next line, you find when you scan it, that instead of having five beats, it has six, and tediousness, the limbs and outward flourishes. So it's a line that is hypermetrical.
Right.
It has outward flourishes. And so it's a case of sound imitating sense and conveying wit that way.
Yeah, and I like that you brought up the rhythm, because I think that is one thing that when you're learning Shakespeare and teaching Shakespeare, that's something that has to be taught. But some people, and I would assume those who are musical, kind of just innately then pick it up and then can make it their own with the rhythm and the metrics that Shakespeare has provided.
That's right.
Yeah.
And sometimes editors get in the way, curiously enough. When I was editing an edition of Shakespeare for Doubleday for the Literary Guild, there was one occasion when I was trying to make sense of the way a particular scene in Richard II concludes. And it came down to two lines at the end, which most editors would turn into three lines. And it's a scene where the Duke of York has been left in charge of the kingdom while the king has gone off to fight a foolish war in Ireland. And so he's left York in charge of the kingdom. And just before this speech, he receives several pieces of bad news. And he's pondering all of that. And he says, all is uneven and everything is like, he said, I should to plashy too, but time will not permit. All is uneven and everything is left at six and seven. Those are two lines.
Yep.
And they're part of a speech where there's a lot of metrical irregularity. It's as if Shakespeare wants this speech to sound a little bit awkward because the actor is confused and discombobulated. So he has two lines that do that. And interestingly enough, when you look at those two lines, they are both unmetrical in terms of the metrical form that is normal for the play.
Mm-hmm.
The first line has six beats, and the second line has seven. So the lines are at six and seven.
Yeah. And he tells you right before those two lines that everything is uneven.
Exactly.
Right? So maybe a lot of the direction of Shakespeare is actually in the writing.
Exactly.
When,
and paying close attention to the writing.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I want you, I want to make sure you're able to tell us about what you know, your work with the collaboration with BBC and PBS, because that's basically, I think, what helped introduce all, you know, Shakespeare's classic productions to the living rooms of America.
Exactly.
Took it out of theater and brought it to the television so people could watch and understand the productions.
Yes.
Done there. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, this was a project that commenced in the late 70s.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember actually my first visit to the Players. I was at that time at the Folger Shakespeare Library on Capitol Hill in Washington. And I was asked to be part of the team that would prepare educational outreach materials for schools and colleges and universities to support the teaching of the plays that would be presented on television. And it was a series called The Shakespeare Plays, underwritten by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, along with Metropolitan Life, Exxon, and Morgan Bank, Morgan Guaranty Trust, as it was then called. And so it was launched in February of 1978. It was a snowstorm that had pretty much put New York, drawn New York to a standstill.
Oh, that's hard to do.
But the event went on, and it took place at the Folger, at the Players.
Yeah.
And Jay Iselin, who was president of WNET, presided over it. Michael York was there, a couple of other actors. I think Derek Jacobi was there as well. And we got some snippets of what was going to be presented. And then about a year later, the first of the 37 plays that were televised over a 6.5 year period went on the air. And along with the plays, there were a lot of teaching materials that were developed not only for junior high and high schools, but also for community colleges and 4 year colleges and universities. And so there was a panel that was put together to work with the underwriters and work with the actors and directors to produce all of those.
Wow.
And so it was a real treat to be part of that. And I think it really kind of revolutionized the teaching of Shakespeare. I think for one thing, teachers began to recognize that Shakespeare wrote plays rather than just poems, rather than literature.
Yeah.
And so it really transformed the way Shakespeare was approached in American schools.
Well, I know several people that I've had conversations regarding, you know, where and how did they learn Shakespeare. You know, they read in high school, of course, we all read the plays.
Yes.
But you don't really understand and really get the feeling for him until you actually sit around and read them out loud.
Right.
And so I hope there are some classrooms that are doing that nowadays with the round table. Everybody's got their script, those who don't want to participate, and then those who do, and actually hear the words spoken out loud.
Yeah.
Because
well, one of the fringe benefits for me of being involved in that way was that I believe it was 1980 maybe. When was it that Charles and Diana had their wedding? It was that summer.
Oh gosh, I was still young. My mom woke us up at five in the morning to watch the wedding. So
yes.
It had to have been, 80, yeah. 81 maybe, yeah.
And I was there for a few days. It was turning, that was also a year when there was a conference in Stratford-upon-Avon that people from all over the world would attend. And so I had a couple of days at my disposal, and I went out to the studio in West London where Jonathan Miller was directing Troilus and Cressida. And so I had an opportunity to watch him working. And this was a large building, circular building, with several levels. I think it went up to 7 different levels or something like that. And the director's booth was on the top floor, and most of the filmmaking was down on the first floor. So I ended up spending some time on the top area, looking at his script and so forth, and other times down working with, when he was working with the actors, setting up scenes and so forth. And Miller was a rather whimsical director. He decided that the best analogy for Troilus and Cressida was MASH, because it's a play in which there's a lot of lassitude and discouragement and so forth, and people are standing around doing nothing, trying to figure out what to do next. So he suggested a little bit of the costuming. You could imagine nameplates, for example, of the sort that you would find in MASH. People standing around. He also had a little device in one corner of the space, which I thought was interesting. It was a piece of scaffolding, and you had to look fairly carefully to figure out what it was. It was the beginning of a very large hoof.
Oh.
Yes. In other words, this was the the device that was going to allow for the invasion, the Trojan horse.
Yes.
So he brought a lot of wit to it. And I think the point I came away with was that for Miller, plays the thing. And that playfulness, I think, paid rich dividends in the way his productions were received.
Yes. So speaking of kind of changing, thinking outside of the box for right. Shakespeare productions, I think they happen, I'm sure, all over the world, but certainly all over the United States. And here in New York, there's some updated or just kind of different way to doing one of the Shakespeare plays. Do you try to go to as many of those as possible? Are there any that have stuck out in your mind? I mean, recently, I don't know if you saw Desperate Measures, the musical off-Broadway.
No, I didn't see that.
Oh, it's by David Friedman and Peter Kellogg, but they did a musical version of Desperate Measures, and the entire script is metered time. So, if you haven't seen it, and they bring it back again, it was developed at York Theater, but it ran at New World Stages, and sometimes I love it when I see that brilliant work that kind of brings it into today's world for the younger groups to see.
Yes. I think one of the real geniuses for Shakespearean adaptations is Ian McKellen. Uh-huh. And you may recall his film version of Richard III that was set in the 1930s in a London that was on the verge, if things had broken the right way, it could have become a fascist state during the rise of Nazism. Hmm. And he did it all in modern dress. I think that maybe the real payoff for that concept was in the scene where Richard is fighting and everything is going wrong. And he has a line, a horse, my kingdom for a horse. When McKellen delivered those lines playing the title role, he was in a Jeep that wouldn't start. So, you know, that kind of thing, yeah. where he takes the lines and delivers them straight, but with setting and costume and other devices that add a degree of wit that connects Shakespeare's time to more modern times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what is going on? What are some of the things that you know are going on in some of the other cities? Like, what's going on in Santa Fe?
Well, in Santa Fe, we have a little botanical garden, and it's in the foothills of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains. And I've had a chance to be part of a production of The Tempest that took place several years ago, and another production of A Midsummer Night's Dream. And I will be tangentially involved in this summer's activities. The Tempest was particularly interesting because it was a nice reminder that when Shakespeare was writing The Tempest, settlers from Spain were settling Santa Fe around 1610. So The Tempest and Santa Fe were basically being created at the same time. Mm-hmm. We had made that point a few years earlier by bringing Derek Jacobi and his partner, Richard Clifford, to the Lenzic Performing Arts Center to do a musical version of the play. And again, we made the connection between the founding of Santa Fe and the writing of The Tempest. And it's more than incidental. This is a play that has the famous phrase, brave new world. And it has a number of new world references. It deals with the kind of conflicts that we associate with the new world. between the indigenous peoples who are native and the European newcomers who have arrived and taken over. So the relationship between Prospero and Caliban resonated here in a way that it might not have in another setting or another time.
Right.
And that's the kind of thing I like, is when we can feel that they're, that shape, that words that were written 400 years ago can still speak with the same gusto when they're pronounced on a modern stage.
Yeah, yeah. And that's the same with songs that last through the ages too. The lyrics still have something to say and they still relate.
What are the Shakespearean lyrics that you like the most? I know you.
Oh, well, one of my favorite sonnets that, and it was what I mentioned earlier, the sonnet 29, that's that was put to music in this choral piece. I love that. I'm also a fan of sonnet 116. And I don't know all their numbers off the tops of my head. But as far as musical adaptations, so I trained classically, and Roger Quilter wrote some pieces that are Shakespeare words. Under the Greenwood Tree. But some of my favorite musicals are, of course, Kiss Me, Kate, and West Side Story. And I know that like the RSC and Shakespeare in the Park, I know recently that they've added some songs. They've had songwriters come and add some songs to play throughout the show. And I think that's a great idea, something to do. In fact, did Shakespeare have music in his plays?
Oh, yes. Yeah, there are scenes, for example, in The Tempest and some of the other comedies. I'm not sure how much there would be in the tragedies. There would be maybe occasional songs in history plays, such as Henry IV, Part II. But the comedies, I think many of them would have had music. That would have been an important part of the show.
Yeah. I wrote notes on something. So music and Shakespeare go together. But tell me about speaking of Shakespeare and the Shakespeare Guild and how all of this came to be.
All right. Well, it really began... it was in 1998, I believe it was. I was in Washington at the time. And I learned that Peter Brook was coming to town. He was going to be promoting a new autobiography. And so I arranged to have a program with him at the National Press Club. And it turned out to be a very nice dialogue. And that's where I came up with the name Speaking of Shakespeare. And who better to launch a series with than probably the greatest director of the 20th century, the man whose Midsummer Night's Dream was so powerful that it was probably a decade before any serious company would then, after that, would take a risk of producing the play, because everyone knew it was going to be compared to what Peter Brook had done. So that's how it began. And then that year, I ended up doing several other programs at the National Press Club, one with Cokie Roberts and Linda Wertheimer about Shakespeare in the halls of Congress. They were both reporters for National Public Radio. I did a program with Hal Holbrook, who was in town doing a production of The Merchant of Venice, playing Shylock. Turned out he didn't allow me to talk to him very much because he wanted to introduce a group called the Hobart Shakespeareans, a group of students from California under the auspices of a very inventive teacher named Rafe Esquith. And they were on their way to the Globe in London to present what was in effect a kind of variation on Ian McKellen's acting Shakespeare script, which Ian had encouraged them to use. So that's how it all began. And then not long after that, I was invited out to the new Chicago Shakespeare Theater in the Windy City. And we did a program with Gary Wills, who's known primarily as a historian, but has also done a lot of work on Shakespeare. And also with Derek Jacobi and Brian Bedford over a period of, I think there are three programs in the spring. And then over the years, we've done it at the British Embassy in Washington, at a number of other institutions there. And then primarily now, of course, at the Players mm-hmm. and the National Arts Club on Gramercy Park.
Yeah, which we have enjoyed immensely and are looking forward to more of those in person soon.
So am I.
Now, one of the things you established years ago, also several years ago, was the Gielgud Awards.
Yes.
What made you decide it was time to have an award like that? And how do you decide who gets the honor?
The idea for it came about as a result. I had persuaded Sir John to write an article for an encyclopedia that I put out. It was called Shakespeare's World, Work, and Influence. And he wrote a lovely piece about Shakespeare and the modern actor. Turned out he first said no when I asked him to write this. He said that he had already written a piece for Shakespeare Survey several years prior to that. But I asked him if he might be willing to take that and update it to deal with more recent developments in Shakespeare. And he agreed to do that. And so what he did was make a Xerox copy of the original piece. And then he wrote little inscriptions with arrows pointing to where they should be inserted and so forth. And then a lovely cover note with a PS that said, "I am so sorry, I can't type." And after that, I persuaded him when I was editing the Guild Shakespeare for the Literary Guild. He was willing to write a piece about Julius Caesar. And then later he wrote another essay about The Tempest. And when I got the one about The Tempest, I noticed that he was approaching his 90th birthday. And so I wrote and asked if by any chance he would be willing to allow us to put together a gala to celebrate this occasion. And for the first time, I got no reply. It was weeks before I heard from him. And in the meantime, I saw an article in the New York Times, and it turned out that many of his contemporaries had suggested the same thing, and he had said nothing doing because he didn't want anybody to think that he was finished as an actor. So he was not going to be put on the shelf. And then one of my friends in Washington, Letitia Chambers, said, "Well, have you ever thought about asking if he might be willing to have an award in his name?" And I sent a follow-up note with that idea. And to my surprise, he liked that idea very much. Wow. So about a year later, we arranged a ceremony that took place at the Folger. It was a tea ceremony. And we had several people come and establish the award. Susan Stamberg of NPR read the letter that Sir John had written for that occasion, in which he said that over his career, he had come to feel that America was his second country. And then Robert McNeil talked about how his son Ian, a stage designer, had won an Olivier Award in London for a play that he had designed the set for. And he said that if it was appropriate to have awards in Olivier's name, it was equally important to have one in Sir John's name. And Tony Randall came as well, and he talked about, he told some Gielgud anecdotes And so we were launched, and it was about a year later that we presented the award for the first time at the Folger, with Ian McKellen as our first recipient.
Nice. And since then, I mean, people can go on to what's give the website for the Shakespeare Guild.
And the best way to find it is simply shakesguild.org, shakesguild.org.
Yeah.
And because, you'll find a full history of it there.
And it's just esteemed actor, actress after another.
Yes.
So my question is, are there any up and coming young actors, actresses that have caught your attention that are bringing the words of Shakespeare to life with appreciation and art?
Oh yes, very much so. And I think it's about time. My wife keeps reminding me that it's time to begin honoring some of the younger performers who are doing so much. And beginning, of course, with you, Shana.
Oh yeah, okay. Yes. So, you know, one of the things I enjoy doing as an actor, actress, singer, producer, is reading new scripts. And you know, one came across my computer. We can't say came across my desk anymore, right? Came across my email. That really struck me. And I'm not only going to be a part of it, but I'm also going to produce a reading here at the Players, because the writer combined words of Shakespeare, some Shakespeare monologues and scenes in a contemporary story about the last night in the American Shakespeare Theater in Stratford.
Ah, yes.
And
in Stratford, Connecticut.
Yes. And that's a script that I just really, really had a connection with. But I'm wondering, do you see scripts? Are there more out there that have that are trying to do that same thing? Because what I think is brilliant about it's called Wild Time. What I think is brilliant is that someone who doesn't really know Shakespeare and might not want to sit through a whole play of Shakespeare might get the understanding of Shakespeare in a storyline that is a little more contemporary, but combines sure. his words.
Very much so, and I think Shakespeare would be endorsing this enthusiastically. After all, what he was doing was taking old, either play scripts or poems or you know other works, and adapting them for the stage. So he would give full approval to this. And you may recall, you actually took part in one adaptation of this kind. It was called Ever the Twain.
Yep.
And it was about Shakespeare and Mark Twain's America. And in particular, Mark Twain's rivalry with Shakespeare, how Mark Twain really wanted to put Shakespeare down in order to elevate his own reputation. So yes, I think that kind of thing is very much to be done. There was a play by Richard Nelson called Two Shakespearean Actors. That has been a real, something that has had a good deal of life in the theater. Mm-hmm. So I think, yes, the more the merrier.
Well, of course, there's also Something Rotten.
Did That's you right.
musical?
I haven't seen that, no.
Hilarious. Just, you know, a lot of wit and humor, using a lot of Shakespeare's words, but making it just kind of like a tongue-in-cheek, fun night at the theater.
Exactly.
Not highbrow at all.
That's right.
But a fun night.
Well, in many ways, James Joyce, I guess, described Shakespeare. I think his favorite name for Shakespeare was Shakespeare. And the idea was that Shakespeare, in effect, had created the globe.
Yeah.
And that he was the font of all kinds of works that had been inspired by him, mm-hmm. including a lot of Joyce's own work. And I think Joyce had a kind of playfulness with language that's very similar to what Shakespeare had.
Yeah.
I think he described him as the man who wrote the great folio of the world.
Ooh, I like that. I'm going to write that.
Yes.
Great folio. I'm wondering what time is it? It's 1:45. So let me see if people have sent me questions. So now is the time to send me some questions if you have some. I do have one I know that is ready to go. This question, and it may spur a long conversation, but I knew this would come. So this is from Ralph Bolchins. Shakespeare had good but not outstanding education. How did he acquire the extraordinary knowledge and insights of both British and foreign history and society that is evident in his works? I mean, I think this is leading to that, you know, from time to time, there is that philosophy and that theory that there was more than one writer under the name of Shakespeare. So what are your thoughts on that?
Well, you know, we don't know a lot about Shakespeare the man. And what we have is something that scholars have pulled out of, you know, obscure places. There may be more to be found, but you know, what we know about his education, his upbringing, and so forth is really quite scant. And so it's understandable that some people might think, well, somebody else may have written the plays that bear his name. Mm-hmm. I find that very unconvincing, at least any case that I have seen. But I do think that what we know about the school where Shakespeare probably went, since his father was in effect the mayor of Stratford for several years, is that they had a very strong curriculum in Latin and Greek. They would have studied the classics. They would have studied great works by earlier writers, including dramatists such as Plautus and Terence and Seneca. And Shakespeare would have learned, as so many did in his time, the art of imitation. And you would then extrapolate from what you had learned and do original works based on the kind of work that you had read in what was called grammar school. And a lot of his early works are of that type, for example. So it makes sense that somebody with the kind of background that he had would have had that sort of education and would have learned, as so many of his contemporaries would have, how to appreciate the classics and how to write based on the models that they presented.
Right.
And then, of course, he was working with other actors and theater producers. He would have drawn from everything that was going on. I think he was, as someone once said, he was a man on whom nothing was lost. You get the sense that somehow everything that was happening in his time is somehow reflected in these works, often brilliantly and often very wittily. So I guess that would be my answer.
That's convincing. Have you seen all of Shakespeare's plays?
I think I probably have at least once, yes.
Because
correct. Some much more often than others.
Correct me if I'm wrong. There are 37, thought to have maybe have been 38, but it's 30.
Yes, right. Yeah, he was probably the co-author of the two noble kinsmen, which would be the 38.
Okay.
Yes. And Henry VIII, he may have written with John Fletcher as well. He was a younger dramatist who had joined the company.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of Shakespeare's works would have been collaborative. You know, he was working very closely with actors. He knew what each actor could do. So he was writing parts for Burbage and other actors, Will Kemp, that he knew what they could do on the stage. And of course, in Hamlet, he refers to a lot of this when you have the visiting players come to Elsinore. And right. So he has Hamlet talk to them. And this is almost a way of understanding what it was like to be alive in Shakespeare's time, to hear the conversations between the title character and the visiting actors, mm-hmm. and the purpose of playing as Hamlet describes it. And so in effect, what you have in Hamlet is a kind of history of what it must have been like in Shakespeare's time to have visiting troops come to town. And then what you could do with those players once you had them available. And I think his work must have been very collaborative. He would certainly have taken suggestions from his actors. You know, I can easily imagine Will Kemp saying,
yeah,
that isn't funny, Will. You're going to have to come up with something better than that.
Sure.
And so that's how I imagine it.
I have another one that's come in from one of our Dutch traders. So she belonged, this is Corinne, she belonged to the Montreal Shakespearean Company and played Rosalind in As You Like It. And she doesn't believe American actors have the right cadence in their voices to do Shakespeare. She firmly believes it needs to be a Brit. What do you think of that? And are there any American actors that do stick out in your mind that really bring the cadence, so to speak?
I don't think there's any reason to think that Americans can't do Shakespeare and can't do Shakespeare as well as actors anywhere in the world. And I guess as instances, I would cite F. Murray Abraham. We spoke with him about a month ago, you may recall, and he's played many of the roles. He played Bottom in A Midsummer Night's Dream. He played Shylock in The Merchant of Venice. He's played Lear. He's done a number of major roles. I think Kevin Klein is another actor who has done extraordinarily good work. And then, although he's not American, Christopher Plummer, who grew up in Canada, has, I think, done work that is very much worthy of admiration. Similarly, Zoe Caldwell, who grew up in Australia, but spent much of her acting life in the US. And I think American actors can do just as well as actors from Britain or elsewhere.
So let me ask you this. So would you prefer to see a Shakespeare play in America done just with the actor's normal, regular accent, or try to bring on the British accent?
Actually, what I would be more interested in is an attempt to come up with the language as it would have been spoken in Shakespeare's time. Because when you look at the early printings, it's quite clear that there was a lot of variability in spelling.
Yeah.
Spelling had not become standardized at that time. So Shakespeare and other dramatists could play around with the form and shape of a word. And so I think in Shakespeare's time, the language was really, it was coming out of Latin. You know, it was only relatively recently in his time that vernacular languages were considered to be worthy of literary and dramatic works that wanted to be taken seriously. So I think if you, what I would be very interested in, there's a linguistic historian named David Crystal, who has done a great deal to restore what the pronunciation of words would have been like in Shakespeare's time.
Ooh.
And his son, Ben Crystal, who's an actor, has done some productions, including one that I think the two of them worked on that took place at the Globe in London. And I would love to experience that. I have never had a chance to watch an entire play done in what could be referred to as original pronunciation.
Wow.
And of course, there's no way we could get it exactly right. But I think it's analogous to the early music movement.
Yeah.
Where you have performers going back to the original scorings,
mm-hmm.
and using instruments that are reproductions of the instruments of the time of the composition. And the work that Neville Marriner and a number of other pioneers in early music have shown us is that these works, when they're produced in that fashion, can be very satisfying. And that's something that I would really like to see.
Yeah. What was the name?
He's done a bit of it, but not as much as I would like to see.
What was the name of that that group that does the pronunciation in the true form?
Well, it's a historian named David Crystal and his son Ben Crystal. And I don't think he's actually got a company. He works with other companies. And I think he's done some work with the Tisch School.
Oh.
Because I remember Louis Schieder on one occasion was telling me about I think it was an original pronunciation rendering of Hamlet that he said worked quite well. He said it takes a little while for the audience to adjust their auditory organs to take it in. But once they do so, they begin to get into the flow and it seems quite natural.
And
it's very different from OP, you know, from the, you know, the official pronunciation of modern English.
But I find that very interesting. And what you just said, you know, it took a while for the ear to get used to it. But it's the same for going to any Shakespeare play today for people who don't know really Shakespeare world. Their ears have to really adjust. But if the actor is doing justice to the words and the director has directed it, then it just, the story just continues to flow.
And yes, yes.
I had another question. Okay, so you've edited quite a bit. When you edit, do you go back to the Latin versions and see his original writing and make sure that these volumes are correct in your editing?
Yes, I have done my best to do so. I was first asked to do this by Doubleday, and what I thought I would do would be spending most of my time on the notes to the scripts. But I decided that, just to be honest, I would go back and look at the first folio printings of the plays and at the earlier versions that had appeared in what are referred to as quartos, in effect paperbacks,
mm-hmm.
that in many cases preceded the folio printing. And I began noticing things that I hadn't expected to find. A lot of ways in which the spelling was really quite adaptable. And it became clear that for Shakespeare, spelling was like other kinds of tropes. It would be like a metaphor or a simile.
Mm-hmm.
You could play around with the form of a word for artistic purposes.
Right.
And so what I ended up with was an edition that really gave you a whole lot of the original, of what you would have found in the original printings.
Right.
For example, in Richard II, there's a speech that Richard gives as he's being asked if it is time for him to surrender his crown to Henry Bolingbroke.
Yep.
And his reply is, "I know, no I, for I must nothing be." In the original printing, what we would render as AY, meaning yes,
yeah,
is simply capital I. So it's capital I, N-O, N-O, capital I, for capital I must nothing be.
Ah.
And that's true throughout. And I suddenly realized that this leads to more ambiguity. You can have more than one meaning. It also occurred to me that these were scripts that were meant to be heard before they were meant to be read. In other words, theater is an auditory experience.
Sure, yeah.
That's why people who go to plays are referred to as audiences. They listen.
Right.
So I know no I, for I must nothing be.
Yeah.
Could be translated yes, no. And then he changes his mind, no, yes.
Right.
For I must nothing be. But those are not the only possibilities. When you hear it spoken that way, it could be I, K-N-O-W,
mm-hmm,
E-Y-E. Those are all possibilities.
Yeah.
And what that did was open up to me the whole fact that what we have in these early scripts are often subject to many implications that we don't get when we modernize.
Sure.
And so I strongly encourage anyone who has a serious interest in Shakespeare to go back and look at the original printings,
mm-hmm,
and try to establish an original relationship with those printings. Modern editors can be very helpful, but they bring chronological points of view,
sure,
that can be distorting. And so I think it's possible to make discoveries by going back to those early printings,
huh,
things that you wouldn't anticipate if you know the plays only through 20th century editions.
Right.
21st editions.
Right. So I have one more question, or maybe one and then another quick one. This is from the Dutch Treat Club president, Ray Fox. Shakespeare died in 1616. And the first folio didn't appear until 1623.
Right.
And the scripts of the plays didn't exist. To the contrary, the actors wrote down their lines and their handwritten lines were used to reconstruct the plays. Is that true? I think you may have kind of answered it.
Yeah, I don't think we know for sure. I'm fairly sure that a lot of the plays, even some of the ones that appeared in Shakespeare's lifetime, like A Midsummer Night's Dream or The Merchant of Venice. These are very well printed texts. And I think in all likelihood, they were printed from either Shakespeare's own manuscript or from what would be called a fair copy of Shakespeare's manuscript. And the first folio editors were very proud of the fact that what they had tried to do was to get the best versions of each of the scripts that they printed. In some cases, they were replacing a quarto version with a folio version that they considered to be more accurate as a way of rendering what was actually spoken on the stage.
Right.
And that would really have been their guide. The compilers of the first folio were two of Shakespeare's fellow actors, John Heming or Hemings and Henry Condell. And so what they were trying to do was to preserve for posterity,
yeah,
the scripts that Shakespeare had written to be performed in theaters and heard by audiences. And they were modeling it really on something that Ben Jonson had done several years earlier. He had put together his collected works of his dramatic works. And so there was a model for what Shakespeare's heirs were doing with his scripts. And in fact, Ben Jonson wrote a famous foreword, a poem about Shakespeare.
Oh, wow.
We know that Jonson was not only an admirer of Shakespeare, he could be very critical of little lapses that Shakespeare would make.
Sure.
And we have some recorded conversations in which he makes fun of some of the things that happened in, for example, Julius Caesar. But notwithstanding that, and notwithstanding that Johnson was very proud of his own work, in the first folio, he described Shakespeare as not of an age, but for all time.
Wow.
And I think you know, we can take his authority very seriously, because he was somebody who had earned the right to speak as he did about Shakespeare. So he put Shakespeare in the same class as Aeschylus, Sophocles, Eurydice, and so forth, Euripides, and Seneca. He helped make Shakespeare a classic.
Yeah. Well, I think that's wonderful. And I think he is a classic, and I think he is for all time. Yes, Shakespeare.
There he is. I think he's smiling. I can't tell for sure.
Hopefully, but... hello.
He's kind of like the Mona Lisa.
Yes.
Thank you for doing this, and we hope to see you in person soon.
Very soon.
Have fun in Santa Fe. Oh, there is one person here who said, have you ever worked with Robert Benedetti?
I have indeed.
Actors Lab. Okay.
He's written one of the standard, I think two of the standard books about classical acting.
Okay.
And he runs a theater company very modestly called the New Mexico Actors Lab.
Yeah.
And I'm very proud to be a member of his board. He does great work.
Great. Well,
so you'll have to come.
Oh, next plane.
All right. Very good.
But thank you so much. And I hope to see you soon.
And I hope so as well, Shana. Thank you. And all our best to the to the players and
Street Club. And yeah,
exactly. All right.
All right.
Thank you very much.
See ya.
All right.
Bye.
Bye-bye.